the question will go to specifically on which we are using. For example, collecting the data that are like temperature and the rainfall in the field. In temperature and rainfall data. And also in the field, I'm collecting the host and the interactions. So I have two now questions. How this, if I'm deciding to use, let's say, maximum, how am I going to convert this to interactions and the rainfall?
The way it has been used is that you model the distribution of your interacting species. If you're interested in the
very specific the model now. If let's say 3 years, this we call the climate variability or climate change.
No, that's climate variability.
They said now I have 10. Is that 10 years?
Yes. For talking about climate change, you need decades of climate data in order to understand these variations, because there are inter-annual and data-level variations, natural variations in climate, or even longer. So the longer you have your data set, it's much better for predicting patterns.
In fact, climate is usually defined as average conditions over 3 to 5 decades.
Okay, so now my question is, especially when we have my data, how am I going to incorporate the mass? Because I see here we are using the remote sensing data when we are running our model. So as you know, we are collecting several data. How we can go to the model and see.
For specifically your climate data and your remote sensing data, you need to generate surfaces of from your point climatic data. processes, because the requirements are that data is in vast form, environmental data is in vast form. So you need to generate this vast form.
I was trying to attempt this kind of approach to future scenarios, and I read some paper by Moss, who was looking at plants and how plants in the, I think, North America will respond to climate change. And he incorporated something that was also trying to put the effect of dispersal. So he looks at two dispersal. So he has what he called full dispersal and non dispersal. And I don't know how we implement it here, but when I tried it, I realized that if you make these two assumptions that, for example, plants or fruit flies will be able to look for new, suitable areas, that's the full dispersal, you actually get different results. Under the full dispersal, there is less change. The change, very few of them, like I had 10, on about two of them under future scenario, were actually showing losses of area. And at the other one, it's actually different. Now my question is, how would you implement full and non-dispersal, for example, in open modeling?
It's not a matter of the algorithm you are using, because those are assumptions you are using, you are having when you do this modeling. When you assume that it's full dispersion, it's meaning that all the potential distribution modeled for the future will be occupied by the species. And when you are using the assumption that no dispersal will occur, is that you are not allowing the distribution of the species to go beyond the actual distribution. But this is when we have no idea on how this person is going to be for the particular species, which is most of the cases. The trick here is that how can we incorporate our knowledge on dispersal of a particular species into the model? And those are the new approaches that that has been developed recently.
So just the very simple answer that you can do right now is, let's say you do your present day projection and your future projection. So the full dispersal is saying anything that's suitable in the future is distributional area for the species. The no dispersal assumption is that only those parts of the present that remain suitable in the future, so it's basically clipping the present by the future, only those parts, the intersection between the two. And those are operations you would do in QGIS, post-modeling. Okay?
What about if you project for the future and the niche is shrinking. What are you projecting in the future? We are discussing yesterday, and find out the niche was shrink in the future. What would you say about that?
The niche is shrinking?
Shrinking.
Or the spatial footprint of the niche?
The niche.
So you're imagining change in the fundamental niche?
Yes.
So that's a different process on top of what Enrique's been talking about. Remember, he set out that an important fundamental assumption is that niche evolution is slow in comparison with environmental change. And that's certainly true looking forward, okay? Because we have very fast anthropogenic climate change. So if the niche were changing in any way, then that's a different set of dynamics that's going to change the distribution in ways that we really can't anticipate. The niche could be shifting, could be expanding, could be shrinking. But again, make carefully the difference between change in the niche, per se, evolutionary change, and the fundamental niche. So essentially, physiological change versus change in the spatial footprint.
What's the difference between change in spatial footprint and change in the niche?
Okay, let's imagine that you can only survive between 10 and 15 degrees centigrade, right? Well, evolutionary change in the niche might be that that 10 to 15 degrees changes to 10 to 18 degrees. So that would be broadening the niche. So that is change in the niche, where the set of conditions that you can survive under increases or decreases or shifts. That niche can stay the same. It can be at 10 to 15 degrees centigrade, but all of a sudden, all of Africa or none of Africa could fit those conditions. And so you could go from your current distribution to a much broader area, or from your current distribution to a much smaller area, depending on how much of Africa has those conditions of 10 to 15 degrees centigrade. Okay? So make the difference between the dimensions of the niche per se versus the spatial manifestation of those conditions.
What you see with the models is not has nothing related to niche evolution. It's only the spatial expression of the niche.
So one last question.
Scenarios or with different algorithms. So areas with higher consistency, you would think that are more reliable in terms of the outcome. But still, if you didn't have any validation data, you cannot be sure.